rock and roll capital.
It's time for a show that'll open your eyes and your ears.
You don't need to worry about health insurance here.
Rest your lips, put down the
skirt. It's time for Band-Aid.
With your host, Doc Rock.
All right, it's Tuesday and it's Cleveland, yeah! Thank you, and a worldwide web welcome to Band-Aid with Doc Rock. I am Doc Rock, your rockologist, and we are live and in living color podcasting from the rock and roll capital of Cleveland, Ohio! All right, now you all know this, but I gotta keep telling you this. Band-Aid is a global and interactive weekly forum designed to help bands get better. You know, these are indeed some really tough times, so we're here to tackle your challenges in the music industry. And I'd like to say thank you, sincerely thank you, for spreading the word and for linking us on all of your sites. You know, we continue to grow in viewership with every show. It really excites me to keep going with this. It's kind of fun. So, but one thing about it is, it's your show and it's all about supporting your success. And of course, if you've missed any of our archive shows, and there's so many of them, almost 18 months worth, with so much content there, just go to www.bandaidwithdocrock.com, you know, and check it out. This website offers a large assortment of music industry related links that are listed on the sitemap as helpful resource links, because that's exactly what they are. You know, we also invite your suggestions for adding additional music industry resource links. You know, there's so much happening out there every single week. I get excited about it. I try to pull it together and present it to you because, again, it's there as a helpful resource for you. So share them with me if you find them, all right? You know, you'll also find a page in this website listed as Recovery Room Interview Application. I know. You know, if your band's in Cleveland on a Tuesday night and they want to appear live in our recovery room for an interview, yeah, I'm game. I'm interested in hearing from you. All you have to do is complete this very short application. Just click on Recovery Room Interview Application, complete it, submit it to our artist relations staff for their review and potential scheduling. So, love to know more about you. All right, tonight, as always, we're in the chat room having a little bit of fun tonight. So please, you'll see also to our email address, show@bandaidwithdocrock. You know what? You can use it tonight and use it anytime, 24/7, 365, because this stuff excites me, obviously. And you may have future show topics. You may have suggestions for this show. It's important. When you share all of your ideas, it helps all of our viewers. And remember one thing, we are in this rock together. All right, of course, I could not do the show without our talented production team, and they're all in the house tonight. The intern wizards have flown back in here tonight. Yeah, making it all happen. It's kind of fun. My buds from Social Racket are out there just cranking it out on the web. Jared Holly, my man, is out there doing his thing around this country. And, of course, the incredible Flying V, he's the big nervous guy pushing all the buttons who makes this happen. I couldn't do the show without any of them, and I say thanks to my production team for keeping us going and soaring every single week. Okay. All right. I admit I'm getting older. I know. It's not easy, okay? And you get cranky and everything with it, but Doc's blood pressure is elevated again this week. Oh, yeah! All right, you know, here's the reason why. I go to an occasional live show. I stand back and I just listen after the show to what goes down. Because what goes down after the show is as important as what goes down during the show. What gets my blood pressure up? Bands saying the wrong things to fans after the show. That's right, I'm saying it. You know, the show is over, the gear is packed, your loadout is now all complete. All band members should go to the merch table to greet fans and drive merch sales and fan interaction. So bands stand there and go, yeah, check out our website. Or they'll quip, glad you liked the show. Or worse, like, hey, want to buy something? If your band is caught in this mindless verbal trap, then you are really missing out on fan growth, and that gets my blood pressure going. Bands, the number one rule is fan engagement. And to fuel fan frenzy enough that the fan will do all the viral blogging and marketing to grow your band. The fans will work for you. All you've got to do is arm and encourage your fans. As humans, we all like to be recognized and valued. It's human nature. But in order to get your fans to embrace you and to help you consider, help you really with your growth, I want you to consider the following statements in this order. One, fan walks up. What's your name? Two, did you like our show? Three, was there any favorite song or part of the show that you really liked or you would change? Four, do you like our CD or our t-shirt art? You know, show that to them. Five, any suggestions of how we could do better? Six, will you help us and stay in touch? And seven, here is our website. Now imagine with those seven magical sentences what goes down in terms of an emotional exchange, okay? A very big difference. The fan now feels engaged. By following this important sequence, your fan feels like they now have a say and a genuine vested interest in helping with your success. They're engaged. They like you. They want to help you. Okay? You're not pushing them off. No. You are not a rock star. And there is no room for egos or rock star antics. The rock star manual is long gone. Torn and gone. Okay? Even the pros live by this creed. They have to today. Every fan is vital and valuable and needs to feel very special, and you need to go out of your way to do that. Always be kind, always be positive, and you will experience very positive results. Word up from your doc. All right. I want you to open wide and get ready for Doc's weekly prescription! Okay. You know, please, bands, one band member or a close friend should take a basic course to learn both Pro Tools and Photoshop. The time is now. You know, there are now so many colleges and trade schools offering basic courses to learn these very vital tools. There is no excuse not to have somebody in or near your band knowing them. You know, these tools are vital for editing and enhancing your products and your byproducts. Knowing them would save you plenty of money to be able to do all in-house with your band. Now is the time. It's available everywhere. There's no excuse not to do this. I hear from so many bands who have such great ideas, but they totally avoid them because they cannot afford to execute them properly. You know, they cannot afford to be paying for these professional services, so they just skip it. And what happens? Lame product. So all the fans and potential prospects just get lame product in a world where the new world standard expectation is of a lot more intense presentation. You know, the market in both the software and the related education has come down to a consumer level. Now is the time. You need to be complete, or you'll soon be obsolete or even deleted. So bands, get moving, pull those services in-house, and get her done. Swallow this wise and sometimes painful prescription, get to work, and you'll get better. All right. Speaking of great efforts and great education and great things, you know, I always talk about this each show because it's so inspiring to me. My friend, mega guitar tech guru, Mark Race, who has been on this show, you know, he is the tech of the biggest names of the industry. He's the tech to the big stars, you know, but he gives back. His guitar's giveaway project is called Our Sacrifice at oursacrifice.org, and he supports five veterans organizations, and these are grassroots organizations. And he supports them by giving away incredible donated autographed premium guitars. I want you to listen to those four words. Donated autographed premium guitars. Even with a few amps. You know, it's incredible. You will be blown away when you go to this site and click on the donor artist link, you know, and see what's out there. Wow, great stuff. All you gotta do is just purchase a raffle ticket. Okay, it goes into the hopper. And you know what, if your name's not drawn that month, it stays there. It's perpetual, it keeps going each month. It is a great investment in the name of patriotism and a great investment for the potential of what you could win. So check out oursacrifice.org. Again, great patriotic cause. You know, it is my favorite cause. It is something that we should all be doing. All right, now it's time for those weekly artist injections. Yeah. Okay. You know what? Everybody likes to live for tonight. So I just have to adjust the thing for you. How about a punk and rock band from Long Island, New York called Live for Tonight? Or maybe Live for Tonight? They could be one of the two, but it means the same thing. So we'll say Live for Tonight for tonight. Okay, Live for Tonight is a dynamic quintet consisting of Matt, Christine, Corey, Chris, and Tommy. You know, their pure volume profile, well, it's non-existent. So I don't even know who plays, you know, what in a band other than the posted statement that the band is male-fronted. So Christine, well, she's probably not the lead vocalist. I don't know who is. They didn't post any of this. What's up with that? You know, there is no dedicated website listed, so there's nothing more to learn or even report about Live for Tonight. You know, I was able to view 3 promo pics, but no live pics, no candid fan pics, hardly anything out there. I guess this band is really exists. I assume they're living for tonight. You know, you can continue your assumption that there is no merch or even videos available, and you would be correct. Nothing's there. What's wrong with that? There's so little basic marketing to enliven new fans about Live for Tonight. It is tragic and leads to eventual certain death. You can only be indie to a point. Live for Tonight, though, they did manage to release an EP of 4 tracks in May of 2011. It's entitled This Year's Autumn. It is a nice start and full of biting guitar melodies and harmonies to really grab your ear. You know, there's a very firm rock foundation that's both primitive and it's very energetic. You know, the dynamic emotion is there and it's just kind of spewing out that pseudo rage. Live for Tonight can also have their very diverse and tender moments for just short spells. I want you to listen to the hauntingly creative tune Hello Snow, Goodbye Best Friends by Live for Tonight and see what they can shovel out. Listen to this song.
So I guess the snow means I'm staying in tonight. It will keep me away from you for just one more night. You've got me wrapped around your fingers, oh, so tight. And I can't help this feeling when it feels so damn right tonight. So I guess I'll just have to admit that you're everything that makes my heart tick. And you've got your ways, and I found my place. And I'd be so lucky if I just saw your face tonight. Tonight.
Hello, Snow, Goodbye Best Friends by the Long Island band Live for Tonight. You know, it's a really great tune that is really well arranged, and it generates interest, you know, in this very, very young New York band. You know, they have other tunes like So Much Love that deliver raw and punchy vocals along, you know, to an effective riff and a really frenzied beat. The tune In All Honesty, A Means to an End, also has a captivating melody. You know, their tune Break Hearts, Not Records, I love that name, Break Hearts, Not Records, is ablaze with sharp, precise breaks and a total power vocal. Good stuff. Good vocals. Live for Tonight have impressive vocals for their male frontman, but I just wish we knew who he was so I could congratulate the man personally. You know, so on a scale of 1 to 5 on the Band Aid musical scale known as BAMS, I embalm this punk rock band, Live for Tonight, with, let's see, yeah! 1 BAMS for having a tight and truly alternative vision. You know, they really dwell on being indie. It's okay, I understand. Okay, let's see, and yeah, let's do it. 1 BAMS for some solid creative writing and lyrics to capture and hold your attention. You know, their first EP is a really great sampler of their potential, and they've got some really great recording potential. So that's a total of 2 BAMS for the Long Island, New York quintet called Live for Tonight. You know, Live for Tonight need to pull it together and fuel fans with more fodder. They have the talent and the energy to stay creative in a world of just mundane wannabe punks who have the great band names, but very little else to back it up. I hope this band one day enthralls fans and critics alike, that they would all live for tonight. Okay, you know what? Since I'm in that New York state of mind, well, let's get epic. Oh, yeah, that's right, because the dynamic hip-hop, rap, and pop killer who calls himself Epic hails from Cortland Manor, New York. That's right, his real name is actually Ethan Portis Chaikin, but, you know, he's found on Pure Volume as Epic, on point. And he certainly is on point as one very creative artist. His profile is a little bit on the light side, but you get a sense of his style. You know, there are 10 assorted promotional pics posted along with some really creative art concepts, and Epic certainly has a keen wit and a fun sense of humor. You'll know it when you check this out. You know, but Yepper, you are right, you are right. I know, there is no merch available, there are no vids posted, so, it's not so epic for his marketing plan, even for an artist of this level of talent. Even some basic interview videos will always serve you well, just some candid, some basic stuff. Post something. Epic is a wall of core urban and street shots. You know, he's most definitely a recording genius inspired by some homeschooled Jersey homies of the day. He's posted plenty of singles and 2 albums in 2011. He's been very busy. First album is called Blue Brains. And of course, the other one is the title is Edge Hip Hop First and Finest. That's the other one. He's been a very busy man in 2011. Cool stuff. But you know, he's a very shrewd and wise marketer because everything he does is a free download. That's right, completely free download. Epic knows the value of creating his art and making it easily available to his peeps. And bands, that'll get you ahead a lot further just to get your music out there in the marketplace. And Epic knows that. You know, Epic lays down the lyrics with real hard smack. There's no sugar found here whatsoever. His lyrics are rude and crude, yet graphically creative, as evidenced in tunes like, You Stank, Ho. That's right. You know, he kicks some really strong hooks and the perfect vocal effects to capture the genre well. He's risk-taking and could not care what is PC, much like the street itself. His mondo beats are really down to move you. You know, he drives to brand new directions and he cuts it real with cold verbal steel and a few blades. He is dangerous. Let's get colorful and listen to the tune, Purple, Yellow, and Green by Epic. Listen to this song.
You're waiting for it to be put in. It's not worth it. You are the one who deserves it. Knows I got assets, and baby of the casket, I need to stay fresh.
and I ain't trying to play you. I work in intervals. I need to freshen my game before I go beyond these four walls. And if you're ready, girl, I'm ready to come running after you. Won't you stick by me through and through? And time is ticking for us, cause we are filled with lust, and we'll make amends so we don't get fucked. But if I'm getting fucked, I'm getting fucked with you. And if one thing is true, baby girl, it's that I love you. And I can't take the time to fucking fake these rhymes. So baby, take the time to put your hand in mine. Even throw it all away. The future is a feature, and I'm ready for it. I'm living by the fucking book so I can settle my shit. And if your mind is trailing off, take a fork to me, and I'll bring light into your castle, Miss Majesty. And if you're happy for yourself, I'll be happy for me. I'm blindsided by your eyes, they dumbfounded me. Could you bring tears into these eyes? Maybe tears of joy. I don't think I'd rather be any other boy, cause I got you as a friend, you got a friend in me. Let's color this world purple, yellow, and green.
The tune, Purple, Yellow, and Green by Epic. You know, it's mild compared to his urban prose and rap. Yeah, Epic is really on point with lyrical assaults and hooks with amazing arrangements. He knows it, and he rules the recordings. You know, I'm certain that his jam, Toker's Delight, will not be your school's anthem of choice, but it sure hits the mark with that classic Epic style. So, by the way, I gotta tell you this, he is off to London later this fall. That's right. I don't know if he's performing, I'm not sure what it is, but he's headed off to London this fall, and so no other gigs are really posted. He's probably getting ready for that great opportunity, and wow, that is a great market for a man of the quality of Epic. So on a scale of 1 to 5 on the Band-Aid musical scale known as BAMS, I take aim at Epic and I fire, ha, yeah! One BAMS for a convincing and a very, very confident artist in the truest sense. You know, it is in all of his terms, this guy is really on his game. And of course, well, maybe, yeah, let's do it. One BAMS for a very creative and provocative approach to his recordings. You know, Epic is nothing more than a street soldier who takes no prisoners, and may one day, he might even be one himself. He's not a true gangster, but you know what? He's a master of reflection in his very artistic world. So, that's a total of 2 BAMS for the New York slinger called Epic. You know, I like him. I actually do like him. He makes art. He feels his art, and he goes out there and he gets it done. He could easily be just another post-urban lost soul, but is clearly committed to taking you to the bottom and watching you wince with his music. He is genuine. He is, well, he's epic. All right. That's all the artist injections that I can handle for this week. I like the buzz. So it's so cool to discover and inject all these creative and deserving national talents. And of course, we're looking for your opinions on these weekly artist injections. Just visit our dedicated show website at bandaidwithdocrock.com and click on the injection artist input link. All you got to do is enter what you have to say to me about future injection artists and send it along. You know, your opinion matters. We post on that under future shows, the upcoming injection artists, so we want you to do that. You know, I want to hear from you. All right. You know, we often use the term culture loosely these days. We covet genuine pop culture and the associated memorable events that mark those special times in our lives. You know, it all now moves so quickly in our digital world of instant access. So who, what, where is culture today? Celebrated author and Plain Dealer reporter and columnist Michael Heaton is he's the well-known minister of culture and has been for decades. Listen to his amazing experiences and reflections to determine how to define the best of these modern times in order to realize and inspire your creative expression. The minister of culture himself, Michael Heaton, is in the house and will be right here after this break. So, my name is Doc Rock. This is Band-Aid with Doc Rock here on MorningShowCentral.com. Woo, it's a hot one here tonight. Looking forward to Michael Heaton, the Minister of Culture. I want you to go grab a cold one and I'll BRB and be back with you in just a few. We'll see you in a minute.
Supplement Studio. You're listening
to Morning Show Central Radio Network.
Cocaine Energy Supplement.
Due to great consumer demand,
Redux Beverages has officially announced the return of its world-famous Cocaine Energy Supplement.
It's now available at retail locations across the country,
as well as online at RedoxDirect.com.
That's RedoxDirect.com.
Don't forget to be part of the all-new Cocaine Energy Supplement social network,
where you can meet other Cocaine Energy Supplement fans from around the world.
Cocaine Energy Supplement.
You can become a member.
You can become a member by logging on to LoveCocaine.com.
Unbound. Unstoppable.
Uncensored Net Noise's birthday bash.
Yeah!
Get your ass to Fantasy Nightclub in Lakewood on Friday, September 23rd.
For live music, for Morality Check, Demons Within, and The Thousandfold.
Hosted by comedian Anthony Savant.
Uncensored Net Noise's birthday bash.
Sponsored by Cocaine Energy Supplement.
Get more details at MorningShowCentral.com.
Your body moves, it feels so right. Shake up your hips, the taste of your lips drive me wild. Sweat begins to bead, dancing in the sheets. Start to take over, find yourself in the lead.
nine technologies.
Affordable and reliable web hosting done right.
Jumping from one web host to another can be frustrating.
Finding a good web host can be unnerving for even the most experienced of web designers.
That's why Uncensored NetNoise has chosen P99 Technologies as its web hosting supplier. Established in 1999,
P99 Technologies has evolved into a first-class web hosting provider.
Its 99.9% uptime rivals many in the industry. That's why they offer their 30-day guarantee.
No questions asked.
For more information, go to P99.com. P99 Technologies will help you get started with your web presence.
With honest and expert customer service.
P99 Technologies. Affordable and reliable web hosting done right.
Trouble. offensive language. Yeah! It's the noise.
Friday night,
9 p.m. to midnight.
Don't go in there. Promise me you don't go in there.
Uncensored net noise.
Uncensored net noise.
On morningshowcentral.com.
Oh, great. Not another Farmville request.
Check us out on Facebook at facebook.com/morningshowcentral.
Denying one Farmville request at a time.
Welcome back to Band Aid with Doc Rock. I'm Doc Rock. We're here for the rock and roll capital of Cleveland, Ohio, and the Minister of Cultures in the house, Michael Heaton. Hey, how
brother,
are you tonight?
What's up, man? Good to see you again.
Good to see you too, brother. Yeah. Okay. Now, if you're a Clevelander, you have to know Michael Heaton. And if you don't, tune us out, okay? You're in the wrong spot. This man is the Minister of Culture. Let me tell you a little bit about his illustrious career. Michael Heaton is an award-winning columnist and reporter. You know, his byline has appeared regularly in the Plain Dealer since 1987. You're an 80s kid, huh, aren't you? Prior to that, he was a critic and columnist for the San Francisco Examiner and a reporter for People magazine. He's a graduate of Kent State University, yeah, and he's co-author of the New York Times bestseller, Motherhood and Hollywood. You know, and his sister is an actress, Patricia Heaton. Of course, she's also co-author of I'll Be Right Back, the autobiography of TV host Mike Douglas. A lot of it before your time, I know, but it's television history. You know, he's got a book of collecting his Plain Dealer columns titled Best of the Minister of Culture. Everybody's read that one. And published in 1992. He's the son of legendary Plain Dealer sports writer Chuck Heaton. He lives in Bay Village. Absolutely. You know, and Michael Heaton has reported on a wide range of stories and is an active Cleveland journalist. On any given day, his byline might appear in any section of the newspaper of record. So, the Plain Dealer, of course, you know, he's a featured columnist and reporter. So, band, you better look out for Michael Heaton. And, you know, to really get the story, he has to put on his boxing gloves and he enters the ring. You know, he's accompanied, you know, a heroin addict. You know, while he's shoplifted, he's fenced stolen goods, scored smack and shot up and driven in a demolition derby. Whoa, how is that for dangerous?
All at the same time, while doing the smack.
Anything's possible, I guess. You know, he's interviewed chefs and coroners, prosecutors and perpetrators, gypsies and priests. And he delivers their stories with a sense of humor and really a great sense of style. This collection of his best newspaper and magazine reporting shows Heaton's Cleveland to be a crazy quilt of bold schemes, failed dreams, and colorful characters, of which you really are one. My gosh.
Okay, I'll take it.
All right, so you went to Kent State University. Did you grow up in Cleveland?
I did. I grew up in Bay Village. I'm back home where I grew up.
Really?
Yes.
Okay, so kind of a full circle thing.
Really? You know, I started in Bay Village.
Okay.
Then I went to Kent State.
All right.
Then 5 years in New York at People magazine.
Okay.
Then 3 years at the San Francisco Examiner.
Wow.
And then back here since 87. It's been 24 years in Cleveland.
24 years in Cleveland. We're glad to have you back.
Okay, thanks. Good to be back.
Paid by the mile.
Could you show the book? I love it when you hold it up in front there.
Well, absolutely. We're going to show this book. This is one of my favorite books. Now, folks, this is Truth and Justice for Fun and Profit. How's that? Truth and Justice for Fun and Profit. Love the cover shot. You know, it's got that classic Michael Heaton bit of suspect to it. So this man is not innocent. You know, great, great book. You know, Michael, but, you know, is there any musical training in your background or anything? You've done all this journalism.
You know, I did a lot of music. I came from San Francisco here to become the rock critic when the Rock Hall came to Cleveland.
Okay.
So that's what really drew me back. And I can't, you know, I only play the radio. That's the limit of my musical talent. But I just always wanted to be near the scene like you.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Love to be around it, got to be, you know, near it. And since I have no musical talent, I wanted to write about it and be close to it. And so I was the rock critic here for probably about 5 years.
All right.
And then I went to the Sunday Magazine, and that book is mostly Sunday Magazine stories.
Okay.
So it's not all music. There's a little bit of music, but that's mostly like profiles and...
Okay, now, but you know, you're a great family man.
Yes.
And I think some of your kids now are in their teens and late teens and stuff.
Yes, okay, 18, 16, and 11.
18, 16, and 11. Now, is dad hip to them, or are you?
No,
you're kind of old school.
Yeah, they don't. Although my kids, one of my daughters went to Reggae Fest this year.
Okay.
Because I took them to Reggae Fest over the years. Ah, so, right. You know, I think maybe they just don't want to admit it, but maybe my back, there might be a smidgen of admiration.
We grow older and we lose our dreadlocks. It's true. Hey, you know what? What type of music do you personally enjoy today?
Well, the big excitement for me today was to find out, to get a notice at my email, Tom Waits is having a new album come out October 25th.
Oh my gosh.
And he sent out the funniest. Today was like a private listing day are a member of TomWaits.com. Uh-huh. And he had the funniest sort of like commercial intro about his private listening party. And I had the biggest thrill this year. I went to New York and went to the inductions New York at the Waldorf Astoria. And I got to see Tom Waits inducted.
And great. For those of you who don't know Tom Waits, you know, he is a great character.
Yes.
Pianist and songwriter. I mean, if you are a serious songwriter, you got to check out Tom Waits. He's in that league with like Randy Newman. And,
absolutely. You
know, of that whole Dr. John.
Dr. John. You know, Dr. John was inducted with him this year.
All the classics. I mean, those guys really, really deliver the character of a song so well. So that's great. So
So this is a big exciting day for me to know that Tom Waits is the new album is near. It's a month away.
Oh my gosh. So Michael, let's go back. You go to Kent State.
Yeah.
I assume you studied journalism.
I did.
Okay. So certainly not fashion at Kent State or anything. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
So you do journalism and stuff. And how did you, did you start out, kind of considering yourself, the typical journalists and all and succumbing to the deadline
I really did everything backwards. Normally, in a journalism career, you start at a small newspaper and then you kind of move up maybe to a larger one. Then you go to a bigger city.
Sure.
And, so you go that way. My very first job was at People Magazine out of Kent State.
Okay.
So I go right to New York City and start working for People.
Wow.
And then San Francisco was a smaller paper. Mm-hmm. And then Cleveland is, you would think I would start in Cleveland, San Francisco, and finish in New York.
Right.
But, there's no real plan. You know what I mean? You just go with what happens.
Well, the wind blows. You're feeling all that stuff. Well, you've seen so many things, and you've been on the cutting edge of so many things. I'm kind of curious. You are the Minister of Culture. How would you define culture?
Well, I got to tell you the story behind where I got that name. Yeah. When I was living in San Francisco, there was a radio guy named Mike Snyder, and he would review Kung Fu movies and monster movies on the radio. And as a joke, he called himself the Minister of Culture. Since you can't own a title, a name, or something like that, I stole it from him when I came here. And it was really just kind of as a joke, because I was really going to be, I'm covering rock and roll, so I thought Minister of Culture is a funny name.
Well, you could have Minister of Pop Culture, because in essence that
exactly.
way it is. But we use the terms so often, and you've seen so much. Again, how would you define culture?
Culture to me is what I write about: books, movies, television, all of that combined. And every week I try to mix it up, like not music every week, maybe movies. Okay, the greatest movie that I'm recommending in Cleveland, I think it's only going to be there till next Friday, Tree of Life.
Tree of Life.
Terrence Malick.
Okay.
It's wild.
Is it really?
Yeah, people love it or hate it.
Okay.
In the first 20 minutes, half the audience leaves. Because they're so freaked out by it.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
The guy who sells the popcorn at the Cedar Lee, he waits. And he goes, 20 minutes, bang, the door opens. People come out. They're like, I hated it. I want my money back, And then of the remaining people, when the movie's over, they come out. Love it, hate it, love it, hate it. I loved it.
Okay.
It's amazing.
Sure.
It'll blow your mind
up. But this is the point. Excuse me.
This
is the very, very thing, Michael. All of these things, books, movies,
television,
all of these things that are surrounding us are somewhat media creations.
Yes,
but they're so invasive in our life, and they're creating kind of who we are. Are we finding
absolutely they inform everything about a person?
Okay, so the thing is with that, the culture reflects the times, or does the times generate the culture?
I think it works both ways. Yeah. I think it's a two-way street.
Okay,
and you were talking about my sister earlier.
Sure, Patricia.
No, she has a new show. Most people know her from Everybody Loves Raymond.
Sure, right.
That was on 9 years. Great she show. Won two Emmys for that.
Yep.
She has a new show now. It's in its third season. It's called The Middle.
Okay.
It's on ABC.
Okay.
It's on 8 o'clock.
Okay.
And a very funny half-hour sitcom. Hilarious.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, you've been through so many almost sitcom-like things yourself. And what was it I heard? I heard about this incredible situation you had with 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
We're going, you know, what, into the 10th year
tenth
of
9/11. 10th anniversary of 9/11.
And somebody was telling me that you had an amazing experience as a journalist in New York with 9/11.
Yeah.
Can you share us the short version of what happened?
Okay, well, basically, on the day of 9/11, I was downtown Cleveland, and an editor came up to me, dropped car keys on my desk, and said, go to Manhattan, get to Ground Zero, tell us what's going on there. And the bridges and tunnels were closed, and there was, like, no way to get in. There was no, all the airports were shut down. The airspace was closed across the country. And I don't want to give it all away because I have a very big piece coming up in the Plain Dealer on 9/11.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Okay.
Where I tell the whole thing. And I made it into Ground Zero within 3 days of leaving Cleveland.
Really?
Yeah.
No other journalists could even get close to it.
Well, there were a couple others. I was one of a small group.
So you won't give away how you did it. We have to see it. Then
yes, okay, it'll great. All yes, all will be revealed on the 10th anniversary in the Plain Dealer.
Really,
which is a Sunday.
Okay, okay, on the Sunday. Wow, that's right. This year, this is Sunday.
It's coming up.
That's
in fact,
amazing.
I was just working on it today. The piece that I'm writing.
Really,
yeah.
incredible story that you got there. Well, you know, you think about things like, you know, like incredible things like the moon landing, and even, you know, more recently the Bin Laden kill.
Yes.
You know, and how we as you know, as artists and bands and all. And as a society, respond emotionally to mm-hmm. these things.
Yeah.
Sometimes to the good, mm-hmm. sometimes to the bad. I'm kind of curious, though, you know, you look at guys like Hunter S. Thompson.
Yeah.
Are you a voyeur like Hunter S. Thompson out for, you know, new experiences?
Absolutely. You know, I worked with Hunter at the San Francisco Examiner. We
Did
were there
really?
At the same time, yeah.
Wow.
And he was an amazing guy, you know, very crazy, you know.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But his writing is amazing.
I tell bands, you know, and songwriters,
mm-hmm.
look into these lives and look into these people
mm-hmm.
who are, you know, who get out and they're on the cutting edge.
Who they admire.
Sure.
Yeah.
They're not just sitting out here, you know, writing basic love songs and teen romance songs.
Yeah.
But they're really getting out there into substance. And mm-hmm. that's what culture, you know, is, that sense of substance. It's real time things happening,
mm-hmm.
you know. And you know, We're so global today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everything's global. Everything's instant access.
Yeah.
You know, on the web and all. But if you bring it down to music, you have seen so much over the changes in rock music. I mean, you were in San Francisco.
Yes.
You know, even in, you know, New York and all that stuff in the 80s. You know, have you seen our culture kind of, you know, be reshaped because of rock music? I mean, our styles have
absolutely.
Changed.
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. I mean, rock and roll really is sort of the voice of young people.
Uh-huh.
And my column last week is about how I find myself going on YouTube and you call up one song and it leads you to another and then to another and then
sure.
to another. 3 hours have gone by, you know, and all the, and I can't wait to get on Spotify next.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
I mean, we all own all the music in the world today.
Isn't that great? Yep.
You know, we used to have these little record collections and these are our favorite and these are our categories. Basically, if you own a computer, you own all the music in the world.
It's an incredible time.
Yeah.
It's an absolutely incredible time for access and all, but you know, you think about the changes in styles and attitudes over, you know, all those years.
Mm-hmm.
You know, look how soul and Motown has gone, you know, into hip hop and rap. It's
yeah.
much more urban, it's much more street.
Yeah.
It's not as polished, you
yes.
know, in those years. And Michael, where did all the hippies go?
Well, I'll tell you where the hippies went. You were talking about Fish earlier,
uh-huh.
working with Fish.
Sure, yep.
And you know, I was I did a story last Saturday about 10 pop songs that everybody should know because they are so influential.
Okay.
And one of them was the Allman Brothers' Whipping Post.
Ah.
Because that was like the father of the whole jam band.
It was.
Genre.
Yep.
You know what I mean? There would be no Fish if there was no Whipping Post. I mean, so, you know, the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that people just claim genres of music as their own, tweak them a little bit, but, mm-hmm. you know, there are strong roots in new music of old music.
And it's really neat because the... you know, when you've been around as long as we have, you see, you know, you see the sort of those retro roots and retro moving into new sounds and things. People still reach back and take the best of,
sure,
you know, those
sampling
years. Yeah, absolutely. But it's just some neat stuff, and it really makes for some great music. One, because it had a prior success.
Yes.
You know, those things were bestsellers and successes.
I mean, you got to honor the greats who came absolutely before you, you know?
Yep.
And
yep,
great news today, front page of the Plain Dealer, Aretha Franklin is going to be honored by the Rock Hall for the American Masters.
Deservingly so.
Yeah.
You know, deservingly so. She deserves the R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's great. You know, what were some of your wildest rock memories from your youth?
Well, you know, growing up in Cleveland, I always tell the story about it was, I think, July of 1973, Pink Floyd coming to Blossom, their first time here. And we had heard on the radio, the show is sold out. Don't come out. You can't get in. Sure. It's at capacity. So, of course, what do? We all pile in a van. We drive as close to Blossom as we can get.
Yep.
And we all start walking through the woods. There were maybe five of us. So we're walking through the woods because we're going to, like, jump the fence at Blossom.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And as we go maybe a mile, we meet five other people, and then five other people. And pretty soon there's 300 of us, like an army, marching through the woods. When we got to the fence at Blossom, the security guards just looked at us and ran away. So we folded the fence down and went in.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
And that was the first time Dark Side of the Moon was played in Cleveland.
Oh, that's incredible. Okay, so I've got to ask you, did you inhale?
Oh, absolutely.
There it is. We got the confession.
All day.
Okay. And that's part of the culture. You know,
yes.
And part of the times that generated the music. You know, the when you look at the internet today, how has it changed us?
Well, you know, the internet is great. You know, I'm on Facebook, and sure, everything I write in the Plain Dealer, I put on Facebook. And I, you know, so it's like, for me, it's a beautiful branding tool. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Just to reach out to more people. They can share what I write, then they can share with other people, and it spreads out, and it's amazing, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. I think it's all for the good.
Uh-huh. Well, so the, but when you take your books and you go through all these experiences and you post it,
mm-hmm,
and even in your books, do you ever have people that rebel against you and say, Michael Heaton, you shouldn't have told that story about me? Or, you know, is it, do you say what you want to say with all freedom?
Yes.
Good.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Good.
No, I mean, that's what makes the stories great. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? You know, don't pull any punches.
Yeah. Yeah. Because your books define the times.
Mm-hmm.
So what, with all the diversity of things that you've gone through, and to the good and the bad and the ugly.
Yeah.
You know, for the fun and profit.
Yes. Right. Right.
But I guess when you're into the depths of, you know, of cultural happenings, all these things going on.
Mm-hmm.
As a culture, we're pulling stories out of that, especially bands writing songs about that. Is it moving too fast? Are we changing too quickly and not?
I mean,
is one trend, one thing not here long enough, and because of the internet, we're losing our attention spans, which are greatly reduced?
I think there's some truth to that.
Okay.
But when you think back about when Neil Young wrote, after Kent State, Neil Young wrote the song Ohio in a week, and it was on the radio across the nation in a week.
Sure.
So that fast.
Right.
But you know, maybe now I think you're right. It could be too fast, where everything's just a blip moving along.
And that song lasted for a long time because when he wrote Four Dead in Ohio,
mm-hmm,
you know, it was about the tragic incident at Kent.
Yes.
And it's one of his most notable songs.
Sure.
Because he actually took the moment to write about a current real event.
Yeah.
And I guess, bands, what we're trying to say is that, you know, gleaning the material for your songs and for your writing, it's happening all around you in very real time, you know, situations and events. And if you know, if you're out there absorbing culture,
mm-hmm,
and taking in all of these things and then responding as an artist to these, you may have your best hit yet.
I'm sure there are people watching right now who have been writing their Libyan song tonight, you know, right?
Or Washington in an earthquake.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's rock the White House and all that stuff. But, some people have been telling me today that with all the politicians in Washington, they never felt it because they feel nothing anyway.
Nah. So, okay. Where were you? Where were you when the earthquake hit?
I was grinding away in my office, you know.
And did you?
No, I didn't.
I didn't either.
I didn't feel any rock and roll. You know, when you get to our ages, we're a little bigger, and it takes a lot to move us, I guess, or something. So, yeah. So pretty interesting. Now, you know, with all this culture and all this stuff that goes on, mm-hmm, Michael Heaton, do you have a temper?
No.
Okay. Well, what pisses you off?
Bad drivers. People in the who are driving slow in the fast lane.
Uh-huh.
I guess I have a temper when I'm driving.
Okay.
Because my wife is always saying, shut up, don't be so mean.
Uh-huh.
Those are old people. They don't know.
Now, you're not a road rage kind of guy.
Maybe I am. Maybe I'd have to admit to that.
Be careful if you're in Bay Village.
We're on 90.
Well, what about, you work downtown at the plane? What about the traffic cameras? The traffic cameras have got to be a real irritation.
Yeah, but I'm aware. You know what I mean? Yeah, it only takes a couple tickets before you know where they are. Yeah. You get that photograph in the mail, you know? Oh, look, there's my car. Did I win something? Yeah.
Yep.
You won a ticket from the Cleveland Police Department.
They are ruthless. I've been ticketed with my hearse. A funeral hearse, of all things. Is there no reverence anymore in this cultural world? I don't even know.
Hey, are you going to... Will I see you Sunday at the Jane Scott tribute?
Yes.
At the Rock Hall.
I have to be there. I admire Jane Scott.
Yeah.
I was fortunate enough to be in one of Jane Scott's columns when I was 15 years of age.
Really?
Rock band, you know, way back in the early 70s. And, you know, is a lovely person and so deserving of everything.
And a pioneer.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
She invented rock criticism.
No, she did. You know, she did. And she was just, just so many bands really embraced her. And she had relationships.
The Beatles.
The best relationships.
David Bowie, the Stones, everybody knew her. Bob Dylan.
Lady Jane, you know, just great person. So, yes, I will be there. I am not driving the hearse. I have a little reverence and dignity.
There you go. There you go.
You know, that's important. With all of this culture, everything going down today, you know, we talk about violence in the movies and, you know, and a lot of things because everybody has access to everything. And because of the sensationalism of everything, Michael, everybody wants a bigger thrill.
Mm-hmm.
You know, movie edits are down to 3 seconds, you know, because somebody can't pay attention for anything longer than that. The camera's got to be moving and moving and moving, you know. Are we better off today, or are we losing some of our quality of life because because there's no characters anymore? Everything is a fast-paced, you know, soundbite.
Well, I think you have movies like that, but I think you have traditional movies that still honor those themes and do character development. Mm-hmm. And so I think if you want that, you can find it. And if you want the faster stuff. Hey, have you seen Conan the Barbarian yet?
No, I haven't.
I haven't either, so okay.
Okay, I'm sure that's fast-paced.
Yeah.
I get people who come back and they tell me all the time, hey, Doc, I saw that Christmas classic, you know, It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah.
And I say, why did you like that movie? Well, because they really were able to embrace the characters, because the edits were not very quickly.
Yes.
You know, not very quick edits.
Yes.
And you got to spend time with it.
Character development.
And I'm seeing, I'll predict tonight, I think there's going to be a bit of a renaissance in personalization, you know, where characters, because you write about characters, your books are full of characters,
exactly.
And, you know, and you are a character yourself with all these great things, but you're only a character and you're only a known band if the public has the chance to meet you, if the public knows you. If you're moving too fast, nobody gets the chance to emotionally and to mentally, you know, understand,
engage.
You know? Uh-huh. And I think really the key word about this is engagement, you know, for bands and recording artists and all. And so it's, you know, it's important. What do you think, you'd mentioned Jane Scott, what do you think Jane Scott would have said about Lady Gaga?
You know, I'm sure that, you know, if we look back in the archive, I'll bet she wrote something about Lady Gaga before she left us here.
Uh-huh.
But I think she would have said that Lady Gaga was a Madonna, you know, 2.0.
Okay.
Because Jane certainly covered Madonna.
Oh, yeah, she did.
Yeah.
Very, very well. You know, but I was just thinking, you know, because of the sensationalism of Lady Gaga, you know, if that would be something to excite Jane, because Jane was
I think
there,
Jane would have said, I'm bored, I've seen this before in Madonna's act.
Uh-huh. Do you tend, as the Minister of Culture, to see a lot of things and experience a lot of things where you're a little bored and you've seen it all before, Michael?
Yeah, as you get older, that really is a sad fact of the business.
Okay.
There's always new things coming along.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? And you just have to dismiss the boring, the fake, and the imitators and look for the new thing. That's what's exciting.
Kind of have to carve through all that stuff.
Huh?
I understand. What about, you know, any of the younger artists, younger bands today, any of these trends that you think are, you know, you could forecast might be going into the future with us, have a little more longevity? where's hip hop and rap gonna go? Where's the whole gang?
I think all the music, you know, comes together. I think that, you know, hip hop loses some of its hard edge and people combine, you know, there's 1,000 mini genres anymore. You know, there's not just hip hop, there's hip hop metal, there's metal jazz, there's, you know, everything is, everything's mixed together. You know what I mean? So you have this wonderful sort of stew of all these things coming together. And it's just interesting to see who's gonna add two things together that have never been added together before and to create something new.
I imagine the, A lot of the artists that are out there today sadly deal with fragmented audiences. You know, it's not a
it's so much harder to get album sales.
It is. And you really have got to, be out there and risk taking, and again, like I say in the show all the time, you've got to go out there and really be ultra creative and trying new things.
And there's not even albums. There's only singles now.
Right, singles and small EPs, things of that sort. Right. No, I agree. Well, again, it's the tools to get your material out there via the internet are fantastic. The best it's ever been.
Yes.
But on the other side of it, there's so much saturation.
Yes, and the competition is just mind-boggling.
And honestly, Michael Heaton, as the Minister of Culture, a ton of mediocrity?
Yes, of course. Okay. In every books, movies, television, you know. But the great ones will always rise above.
Okay, and that's what I want to ask you. Is there any, you know, based on what you're saying with all of these things that you've experienced, is there any sense of wisdom that you pull out of this, that advice that you would give, you know, to young artists today? This is an exciting time. It's a scary time when you're young.
Yes.
You know, the economy has tanked.
Yes.
Okay. You know, and even in our lifestyles, and we'll admit, you know, this is the roughest economy I think we've lived through. Okay, so it's not just something that's for your generation, but with all this going on and all of the, you know, the global events, the good, bad, and indifferent that are going on, when you take it all in, and it's a tough world, what would your advice be to young artists?
I always tell them, it's always been the same. Get out of Cleveland, move to LA or New York.
Okay.
That's where the powers that be are, and those are the big stages.
That's where the business is.
Yes. And you gotta, you know, you can't sit around in Cleveland and wait to be discovered. You gotta go show yourself in the big markets.
Yeah, I tell bands this all the time. You know, when you're going on tour, you know, bands say all the time, "I'm going on tour." Oh, really? Yes, I'm playing a West Side Club and an East Side Club and a South Side Club. That's not a tour.
Yeah,
that's a nighttime gig. Tour means you get your fanny in that van and go to outlying areas. And I always say, you know, geographically, start with like a 100-mile radius around your hometown and expand it to 200 miles and keep growing it out. Build it from there. You know, get out on tour. And I agree with you with the LA New York thing, you know, it's obvious. But when you get to those cities, you can't be intimidated by those cities.
No.
You know, you can't sit there in those cities. You've got to go into the heart of where art is happening.
Yeah.
You know, and be a part of that. I mean, that's where you find your culture and you tend to get discovered. So, your personal career, I've got to ask you, Michael Heaton. More books? A movie? Just gonna hang in there and keep cranking it off.
Yeah. God, I gotta pay for kids' college.
You're an honest man. So. Well, you know, because you've done so much and you've seen so much, and I think it's important that your column in The Plain Dealer, and believe me, viewers, it really is, if there's any column in The Plain Dealer worth checking out, of course The Plain Dealer is great. After you get done with the obituaries and the sports, then you want to go over and you want to read Michael Heaton, the Minister of Culture, on Fridays, is it normally?
Every Friday.
Okay, it's every Friday.
Inside the front page.
Just inside the front page. And then, you know, it's just so important because, again, you know, he pulls a synopsis of all these great things together and these great happenings. And it's, you know, it's great to hear a man who pulls it together rather than just being fragmented everywhere. And again, with a reflection, with a great background in it. And I really admire your career.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
You've done some really great things and inspired a lot of people, including me.
Great. Okay. You know, very good.
I have a doc confession on that whole thing. So it's very, very true. You're a fun friend and it's really great. So I wish you a lot of luck.
Yeah, same to you.
I think it is great having you here. Michael Heaton, the Minister of Culture.
Hey, thanks for having me. Great to be here.
You know, one super guy and a great column. And of course, you learned a lot about this. And it's important. You know, and it's great too because here on MorningShowCentral.com, you know, one of the things is we have all kinds of shows representing all different kinds of lifestyles, and well, some are cultural and some aren't. But you know, the great stuff. All you got to do is check out MorningShowCentral.com, the website. The shows are all listed there, and you know, on Thursday nights, for example, there's a great show. It's from 7 to 8 p.m. and it's called One Life to Play. That's right. It is a core video game show for those core video game freaks. And again, it's called One Life to Play from 7 to 8 p.m. on Thursdays. It's a fast-paced show. Well, you're going to hear news, reviews, and views all about gaming mixed with occasional interviews from some Electronic Entertainment's premier journalists, developers, and publishers. And of course, you can see all these live demos and tournaments, and they even have the Frag of the Week. So it's going to be a real fun show. And always out there on MorningShowCentral.com on Thursdays from 7 p.m. There's another show, too, called Since 1974 Radio. Michael and I can really relate to that. Since 1974 Radio, it airs Sundays from 4 to 5 p.m. You know, if you're a hip hop, rhythm and blues, or just a basic blues freak, you know, it is all there. And it's just such a great platform for these worldwide artists of those genres. And of course, they have just the streaming 24/7 audio at a website called since1974radio.com. And of course, for all of you who are celebrating MorningShowCentral.com, well, our most popular show is called Uncensored Net Noise. And yeah, Uncensored Net Noise has been out there for, gosh, over 5 years now. And they're having a really popular birthday bash, which is a great annual event at the Fantasy Nightclub. And it's on September 23rd. September 23rd, you know, comedian Anthony Savat will be the MC. The band's Morality Check, a band called Demons Within, and a band called A Thousand Fold will be rocking the house starting at 9 p.m. at the Fantasy Nightclub. Tickets are only $5 if you're 21 and over, and $8, okay, if you're 21 and under. But visit MorningShowCentral.com for details. It's always a party with Uncensored Net Noise. You know, I want to tell you that also, too, if you're going to come down with a great idea and tour our studios here at MorningShowCentral.com, all you got to do is email Chris at MorningShowCentral.com. He's the owner. He's the engineer. He's the guy that cleans the bathrooms. He does it all. He shovels the snow out of the parking lot. But he'd love to hear about your idea for a new show. Sure, we've got slots for you. If you've got an idea for a show, all you got to do is email Chris at MorningShowCentral.com. Come on down and get a tour. And while you're here, you can visit the most incredible free market green screen studio in the state of Ohio. That's right. We actually share the building with them. It's called Creative House Studios. Check out the website, CreativeHouseStudios.com. It is impressive and the ideal place to do a really great green screen production for your next music video. All you got to do is contact Peter. Peter Sampson's at 216-225-6592 or email him, Peter, at creativehousestudios.com for an appointment. You will be impressed. And, of course, you can bring in your own camera crew. Use their amazing facilities. It's a free market studio, and, boy, is it impressive. So all these great things are happening here around downtown Cleveland. Use it, okay? Get down here, visit it. We want to learn more about you and show you these great assets in this city. Hey, I want to tell you, too, that after this short break, we're going to meet the artist who has the most coveted album in the region. That's correct. If you've not heard about the album called Acetate, then you've really missed something special. The brilliant solo artist, Chris Allen, will be right here next in the recovery room on Bandy with Doc Rock. What a great CD. You don't want to miss meeting Chris Allen. So, I'm Doc Rock. This is Bandy with Doc Rock here at MorningShowCentral.com. Grab another cold one, and I'll see you in a few in the recovery room.
MSC Radio Network has just tweeted the following.
This bowel movement won't come out.
Check us out on Twitter. At twitter.com/MSC Radio Network.
Cocaine energy supplement.
Due to great consumer demand,
Redux Beverages has officially announced the return of its world-famous cocaine energy supplement.
It's now available at retail locations across the country,
as well as online at RedoxDirect.com.
That's RedoxDirect.com.
Don't forget to be part of the all-new Cocaine Energy Supplement social network,
where you can meet other cocaine energy supplement fans from around the world.
Cocaine energy supplements.
You can become a member.
You can become a member by logging on to LoveCocaine.com.
Unbound. Unstoppable.
Uncensored Net Noise's birthday bash.
Yeah!
Get your ass to Fantasy Nightclub in Lakewood on Friday, September 23rd.
For live music for Morality Check, Demons Within, and A Thousand Fold.
Hosted by comedian Anthony Savat.
Uncensored Net Noise's birthday bash.
Sponsored by Cocaine Energy Supplement.
Get more details at MorningShowCentral.com.
Trembling hands.
Done right.
Jumping from one web host to another can be frustrating.
Finding a good web host can be unnerving for even the most experienced of web designers.
That's why Uncensored NetNoise has chosen P99 Technologies as its web hosting supplier. Established in 1999,
P99 Technologies has evolved into a first-class web hosting provider.
Its 99.9% uptime rivals many in the industry. That's why they offer their 30-day guarantee.
No questions asked.
For more information, go to P99.com. P99 Technologies will help get started with your web presence
with honest and expert customer service.
P99 Technologies, affordable and reliable web hosting done right.
Rise above the clutter, brand your identity, and make a statement. Broken Fan Media, expert video production, television and web commercials, music video, real estate tours, live concerts and events, state-of-the-art post-production, video and audio editing. Check us out on the web at BrokenFanMedia.com, 434-944-0472. Broken Fan Media, the next generation of sight and sound.
If you live the lifestyle, then you should arrive in style.
Lifestyle Limousine Service.
Whether it's dinner for two, an evening at the winery, or a night out on the town, Lifestyle Limousine provides extraordinary service.
Check them out on the web, LifestyleLimousineService.com.
Reserve your ride now.
330-903-0508. 330-903-0508.
Lifestyle Limousine Service.
And make sure you tell them Morning Show Central Radio Network sent you.
If you're looking for the best in musical equipment, recording gear, sound reinforcement, and more,
Guitar Center has you covered.
Guitar Center, located at 26635 Brook Park Road in North Olmsted, has the tools of your trade.
With the largest selection of music and sound gear in the area,
they cater to your musical needs and have the knowledge to help you out. Guitar Center in North Olmsted. MorningShowCentral.com uses them.
You should too.
Need to know more?
Go to GuitarCenter.com.
Broken girl, too brilliant for a dream. Misfits we are, misfits you and me. Graffiti on the wall, tattoos on your feet. Close your eyes and see the world as it should be.
Love not born in this world, simple and sweet. A love not born in this world.
pieces flow together, coming real to real. Lay down the acetate, strip out the self-control. Together we stand. don't look like my town. That don't look like my road. That don't look like my house, 'cause it ain't my home. And I don't live here anymore.
From the Cocaine Energy Supplement Studio, you're listening
to Morning Show Central Radio Network.
Doc Rock, I'm Doc Rock, your Rocktologist. We are live in the recovery room. Okay, you heard me say it before the break, and believe me, this is the most talked about CD right now in the region. It's called Acetate. There is the cover, great art on the cover. Take a look at the backside of this. Look at this handsome artist right here playing the Rickenbacker guitar. Oh, yeah. Well, that is this man, celebrated artist Chris Allen. Welcome to the recovery room.
Thank you, Doc.
Good to see you, man. You aren't gigging tonight. You turned down a gig to be here. I'm so honored. That is great. You gig all the time.
I gig all the time, and I met you a couple weeks ago. We talked, and he said, you're going to do this show. I'm like, I want to take a night off. I'm like, I want to come down here. And the fact that, you know, when you looked at my record, you know it was a Rickenbacker. I said, you know what, I'm going to do this show.
love it. You know, the guitars like cars are stars. Right. You know, it is really funny with branding, because when we see guitars and things, we look at the makes and the models, you know. Right. And it's like when we see a movie, we see a car go by, we'll go, oh yeah, that's, you know. And so we do, so, and you don't see as many Rickenbackers and things these days. So I was so impressed with that, and so impressed with your live show when I finally had the chance to fight my way through the crowd to see you. It was great. So yeah, impressive stuff. Chris Allen, because you're now just up and coming and talked about so much, you know, how long have you been playing and writing? Tell me about your background a little bit. Are you a Clevelander?
I'm a Clevelander, born and raised.
Good.
And really, you know, it seems crazy to say, but 15 records of music with different bands and different incarnations. But I really didn't go, Doc, solo until 2006. So I've done 3 solo records. This is my third Acetate. It's my third solo.
Yeah, because in 2006 you did the Big Apple Circus.
Yes.
2008 was it Things Unbroken?
Yes.
You know, and wow, of course Acetate now. You know, so this is gonna be a hard one to top. You think you can do it?
Well, when I did Things Unbroken, that was a record that I didn't think I could top when I wrote it. So I mean, I was really. I worked extremely hard, and I think I wrote this record probably 3 times before I got down to what I really wanted to do with it. And my producer, Don Dixon, known for doing REM and Smithereens, I sent him the first batch of songs. He said, all right, we're ready to go. I said, I don't think we are. And I said, how are we going to do this record? You know, we've gone in the past, done it with bands, you know, different musicians. And he said, why don't we do it where you feel comfortable, where you wrote these songs in your house? Mm-hmm. So we did it all in my basement, just me and him.
Really?
And just the two of us making the record.
Great quality recording. So, but, you know, going back to the Big Apple Circus since 2006, that's 5 years ago, Chris Allen. You know, have you really grown as a songwriter? I mean, as, you know, as we age and with all the live experiences and things and all the recordings we put out, you know, do you feel your writing style changing and morphing? Do you go back and listen to the big, you know, to the Big Apple Circus and go?
I have, it's one of those. I mean, certain things about that. We were just doing a gig the other night, and my pedal steel player Al Moss said he wants to do a couple songs off this record. I'm like, I've kind of put that behind me, but in terms of a writer, I've just been more confident. You know, it's like I know now. Like when I did that record, I wrote maybe 15 songs, I mean, recorded 11. Mm-hmm. Now I, you know, to me, I got to write, you know, more and more tunes, to get to that point that I want to get, you know, as an artist. So it's about knowing just because you wrote it doesn't mean it's good.
Right.
You can delete.
Amen to that. We've all heard that many times, you know, because a lot of artists say, you know, it's like a baby.
Right.
And I've given birth to this, therefore it's beautiful.
And therefore it's great. And that's great. And we got to record all 50 of them.
Right.
You know?
Right. And it doesn't work. And none of it works.
And I hope, you know, I got, you know, because to me, there's no throwaways on a record. Mm. Every song's got
to
be great.
It has to be. Right.
The whole record, it's got to be an album as a whole. And I'm not one of those people that's like, oh, I got one song. I want it to be great all the way through.
Sure, sure.
And otherwise, it's a failure to me.
But, you know, on acetate, are there songs that you thought people would gravitate toward, and then really they found something different? And, you know, the songs that you think were popular were songs you maybe didn't expect to be popular? Were you surprised?
Every record I've ever done has been that way. Okay. I mean, you know, for this record, you know, We Are Just Kids and The Truth About Being in Love, I thought those, you know, pop singles, those are things that, like, to me, a craft that I worked really hard at. But the things that matter the most to me, like, you know, songs like I Don't Live Here Anymore, that are, and Together We Are, you know, they're a little more, not as accessible. But people that really listen to records, you know, gravitate towards it. And that's, like, doing I Don't Live Here Anymore is one of those songs that people have gravitated towards. And it really thrills me that in this day and age of, like, where people want to just eat stuff up and want it to be candy, people will listen to stuff that goes a little deeper. And I just really respect.
There's so much content in all of your songs and all your songwriting. I mean, you're making some great statements. And that particular song happens to be my personal favorite. And really, almost everybody I've talked to tells me about acetate and singles out that song. Right. Hint, singles out that song. So, you know, at some point, it may be the single from the album, you know, when the time comes. But I think that's a great approach, Chris, where, you know, where you don't go into it with any kind of premeditation and pre-marketing plan, where you just
let
the consumers pick.
You can't decide what people are going to like about things. You just have to do it for your own, you know, personal artistic statement. The rest of it, you know, whatever, you know.
Well, that's what makes you an artist, you know. The you mentioned before Al Moss. Now you've got actually a couple of live configurations, if you will. Tom Priebisch and Al Moss.
Yeah.
You play as a trio, and I'm a huge Al Moss fan. Al Moss.
As am I. Yeah. Al, if you're listening, we love you.
It's got a great history on the steel guitar, you know, pedal steel guitar, and nobody does it like Al Moss. But that's such a great thing. And then there's the band, the Guilty Hearts. Now, you know, I'm curious, what's the difference between the two bands? How do you select, if when you're playing live gigs, which backup artists you're going to use, and do you flavor the gigs?
Well, you know, Tom Priebisch is my, you know, right-hand guy. Where I go, he goes, because to me, we're a two-man band. We can do the harmonies, we can lay down the rhythm. You know, Al has done great to lay down the color.
Sure.
Because I just, you know, I'm a big fan of doing acoustic stuff, but I'm also a fan of making a lot of noise. So when I want to make a lot of noise, I get the Guilty Hearts, I get Don Dixon, Bobby Latina, you know, Dave McKean on the drums.
So Don Dixon will actually play in the
game? Yeah, he plays keys and does all the, you know, he's kind of the Flavor Flav of the band. You know, he does the, you know, the little, you know, tricks that he does on the records, and, you know, great backup vocalist, guitar player, you know, keyboard player. So
you'll find me at the next Guilty Hearts show. I gotta check that out. Well, you know, how did you come up with the title Acetate? It's an unusual title.
It is, and it was, when I looked at all the songs on the record, there was so many different kind of ideas on the album. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want the album to get stuck with any particular thing. You know, and it's like, you don't want to call it, you know, With the Morning Comes the Sun, or different things. I was like, I want people to view this thing as a whole. Mm-hmm. And to me, acetate said
is the
that
whole, it's the reality
is the whole the thing, you know, and just, you know, and I, it's, you know, honestly, I'm kind of a words smith, so I was like, or a fan of words, and I love the word.
Oh yeah.
So I mean, is that, like, you know, I was like, I just love the word. I got stuck on it, and I said, you know, I sent it to Don. We had a list of like 50 titles. Mm-hmm. I said, Don, I sent him acetate, and he said, perfect, and that was it, you know.
Wow. Oh, that's better than vinyl.
Yeah, well.
But by the way, are you ever going to press acetate into vinyl? You're going to do a vinyl
it is. Version? It is on vinyl.
It is on vinyl.
Ghana Groove Records.
Oh, yeah, great company. Yeah.
Vince and all those guys did a great job with it, and you know, it was one of those goals with this record. I knew when Ghana Groove opened up that I had to do it, and meeting those guys, it was great, and it sounded great. And
people have no idea what a gem. Ghana Groove Records. What a great guy that Vince is, you know, and so it just, and a gem, you know, to Cleveland, it's an asset to this region.
It's a huge, I mean, he's doing records, when I was pressing my record, he's doing a Tom Waits record, he's doing a, all these big records, I'm like, you know, they're just, you know, they're going to be great.
Sure. By the way, on this, the packaging is so great, I love the art design, and the photo, you know, who did the whole art concept of this?
My sister Molly always, we've been working together for since I've been making records. And she's a visual artist, she's also a painter. And this is a combination of a painting and a photograph that she took.
Okay.
And she blended all the different, I sent her a bunch of the lyrics and a bunch of the different ideas. So she used all the different lyrics and concepts on the record to incorporate them on the front. And she just blew it out of the wall. I mean.
Oh, no, absolutely.
And, you know, just did a great job with
it. Who took the photograph? Did she do the photograph?
Ruggiero Fatiga.
Okay.
He did the, and we went down to Huntington Beach where I used to work when I was in high school.
Ah, okay.
And we'd done a bunch of different photos. And like, I told him I didn't want your singer-songwriter with a guitar brooding. I didn't want to be on the record at all. My sister Molly, she said, you know, I want you to be on at least the back. Mm-hmm. And we probably shot, me and Roger, we probably did 400 photos, and then at one point he said, why don't you get in the water with your Rickenbacker? And he put on a blue lens, and he said, took one shot, and he said, take a look at this. I said, yeah, let's do 100 of these, because this is the way this acetate feels to me.
And it looks, and it's so cool, because this could be in L.A., San Diego, on the beaches, anything. It's so beautifully captured.
But Huntington Beach.
You wouldn't think Huntington Beach, you know. And, so shows you what you can do locally with a little bit of talent and creativity, right?
Ruined some Chuck Taylors, but it was worth it.
In the end. So, good stuff. The and I noticed on here, as we were talking about before, you know, Rickenbacker guitars. Do you have a particular passion for Rickenbacker guitars? Why? Is it Beatlesque? Is it?
You know, to me, it was the Byrds and Tom Petty.
Okay.
And, you know, a big fan of the Beatles as well, but I was, I think I was 16 years old, and there was a guitar place that's no longer open anymore, a little shop, and they had this Rickenbacker for sale, and I'm like, I really want that guitar, and it was, you know, $2,000, and I said, I'll give you $800 for it, and the guy laughed in my face, and end of the summer, he called me. He said,
really?
I need to get rid of this. And I bought it. It's a 67 Rickenbacker.
Oh,
and,
my gosh.
You know, they're a pain in the neck because they don't stay in tune.
Yeah, literally.
But, I mean, in terms of any electric guitars I ever record, most of them are on that guitar. You know, it's just, even with that guitar, when it's not even plugged in, it sounds good.
It's got a full, the Rickenbacker's always got a fullness to
it. You know,
that.
It just sounds dirty. Yeah. If you play one without the amp on, it just rings in a weird way that's just so great.
Yeah.
And I didn't even play that through an amp before I bought it. I'm just like, that's the guitar I'm gonna spend the rest of my life with if they're gonna let me have it. Hey, and they did.
I bought my very first Fender Jazz Bass in 1965, you know, and I still have it to this day. And I have many other modern
bases. Can I borrow that?
It's a great piece. And it was all of $200, you know, at that time with case, you know. The world's changed, but great stuff. No, I think it's wonderful. You know, and looking at your image, you're a very modest kind of person, Chris Allen, and you know, and very modestly, you know, dressed with this. Is that you, or do you ever sometimes go, well, you know, now that I'm getting popular, I got to kick it up a little bit.
No, you know, I just never bought into the rock and roll thing. Guys weren't, you know, like Paul Westerberg had the great line. It was playing makeup and wearing guitars. And like, I just never bought into, me, like if you come see me play, if you listen to my record, it's about playing hard, working hard. And it's where I'm from. This is the town I'm from, and that's what I believe in. I don't believe in the hype of rock and roll in terms of image. And that's why you see so many people come and go with it, because they do it to get chicks,
or they sell image,
or free beers, or whatever they play music for. me and my friends, you know, we play music because we love it, and that's what we want to do.
Absolutely. No, I don't expect to find you in Lady Gaga's backup band. But recording. Well, you said there's a recording in the basement. Do you have any feelings about analog over digital?
You know, it's... I love, like, my first solo record we did, every record I've done has been analog up until this record. This is all digital.
Okay.
You know, it'd be nice to do all analog if, per se, everything ended up on vinyl, mm-hmm. but it all is going to end up on a CD anyway. At some point, it touches the digital world. Mm-hmm. So the longer this thing's going on, you know, it's gotten, the digital technology's gotten better. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I mean, would I love to do everything on tape, to tape, straight to a record?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'd love to. I mean, like Mule Variations by Tom Waits, put that record on. That's all analog. And it all went right to the vinyl, and it sounds beautiful.
Two-track, half-track format.
You know.
Right in there with it.
But it's nice, you know, the digital format for a guy like myself that, you know, is able to use somebody like Don Dixon. You know, we can record a record at my house and not break the bank. And
that's why.
And that's, you know, let's say all the studios in the city of Cleveland just cringed. So.
Well, that's the curse of the studios. But you know, how did you hook up with Don Dixon? I want to give you this a little bit.
We did, I was in a band called Roosevelt. Okay. We're going to be doing a new record actually coming up mm-hmm. back in the late 90s. And I had sent him... He had been following us a little bit, mm-hmm. and when I started our last, we were on kind of the verge of extinction. We're like, we didn't know what we were gonna do, mm-hmm. and I opened up for him in Akron, Ohio, and we did. I purposely said I'm gonna do all new songs, and I did all new tunes. Don came up to me afterwards and said, you know, we've talked on the phone before, but what are these songs? I said they're new. He said let's magnetize these things. Mm-hmm. I said. All right, and we just became musical partners since then. I mean, wow. He did the last Roosevelt record, The Story of Gasoline, which is our first national release. Mm-hmm. My first three solo records, a Christmas record, my Ohio City Singers Band.
Okay.
And we're doing two records this month in September, Roosevelt and another Ohio City Singers record. So.
Isn't Jesse Bryson?
He was on the last version of Roosevelt. We had two different versions.
Oh,
and he played guitar on The Story of Gasoline
talent.
For us.
You know, really great talent. And Don Dixon, you know, again, he's worked with R.E.M., Counting Crows, The Smithereens, you know. What did he see in this material? What was he able to pull out of you that you just couldn't achieve on your own in the prior albums? Because, and the point behind this, Chris, is I want people to understand the value of a producer.
Well, I never knew, you know, I think with Don, he knew I was crazy as he was in terms of music, but he knew I valued the same things that he did.
Sure.
It was the lack of just BS. Mm-hmm. I remember one of the first tracks we did, he wanted us to set up, we did the Roosevelt record in the Beachland Ballroom mm-hmm. when nobody was there. So we set up mics all around the room and we started doing one of the tracks. And we thought it was all cool. And he said, you are not making an Eagles record. This is a Rolling Stones record. He said, take the capos off and play this thing right. And it was like, I love that. It was like, all right, let's do this thing for real. And it's like, so we just, you know, realized we love the same things about rock and roll. And at the same time, you know, for it to be raw. But at the same time, we both love the Beatles. We both love, you know, crafting a record, making a record, making a pop record. Let's take some chances. And I think with Don, I mean, I think he's always known I'm not afraid to do that. Mm-hmm.
Good.
And, you know, we just kind of jump over the cliff.
But you jump over together. You resonate,
right.
And you know
we
that.
We just jump it over and say, hey, if people hate it, we don't care. If we love it, that's what matters.
I respect him so much as a producer because, again, he's not demanding that you do things on his terms or make changes.
No, it's not.
He's working with the fiber of the artist, you know, to weave something, to weave the best and brightest.
But he will also bring other things that you'd never see coming. Mm-hmm. And it's like, do you like it? Do you want to do it? And I've always trusted his instincts because, you know, I just sonically, one, he's a producer. But he's a musician, he's an amazing songwriter, and he's a great engineer, so it's a, you know, it's a great package,
there.
You know.
Yeah, absolutely all there. You know, Chris Allen, do you consider yourself more of an artist or more of a songwriter?
You know, that's a good question. Because people always consider me a musician, but mm-hmm. I always consider myself, you know, a songwriter first, mm-hmm. more than any. I mean, that's end of the day. If I had to, could only do one thing, it'd be write songs. That's right. What, to me, you know, I'm gonna go home tonight, and I'm like, that's what I'm gonna do. Mm-hmm.
The you know, how do you want the fans to feel about your shows? I mean, I was there and saw this. You captivated this place, that where I saw you live, and everybody was just, you know, admiring song after song of what you were doing. You know, how do you want the fans to feel about Chris Allen live? You know, is it all about, you know, sort of the visual sincerity of your performance, or is it about the music?
It's always been about the tunes, you know. Okay. It's always been about, you know, people coming somewhere there, they feel comfortable to hear music. And sometimes we're gonna do acoustic stuff. You know, sometimes we will be the loudest band on the block. You know, okay. We played Saturday, and there was some, you know, younger bands that had never seen us, mm-hmm. and I think they were surprised at how loud we were.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Well, yeah, and it's important. You have to be able to kick it out. You know, are you starting to see now, you know, fan favorites at the show? You know, people wanting to hear a specific song, you know, because your stuff is so popular,
it just depends on where we're playing. I mean, sometimes it's the, you know, stuff like I Don't Live Here or the acoustic stuff. I mean, mm-hmm. Odessa off my last record, I think resonated with a lot of Clevelanders.
Okay.
Which was, you know, it was written from a place, from a Clevelander.
Okay.
After I'd visited Ray Chapman's grave.
Oh, okay, sure.
And that was one of those special places. There's just a lot of, I mean, I'm an odd Cleveland person. I'm a big Cleveland fan. Mm-hmm. Most people I don't think aren't. Yeah.
Well, it's funny you mentioned Ray Chapman's grave. You know, I think it was the first and only pitcher in baseball that was killed by a pitch.
The only pitcher, and Babe Ruth played in that game.
Yeah, and you know, he buried at Lakeview and all. But it's funny because Lakeview Cemetery within itself, and Lakeview Cemetery in Cleveland, markets itself as a cultural art park.
It is. It's a beautiful, it's a spiritual place. It's a beautiful place.
It really is. You know? Yeah. And I say to bands, you know, if you go to these places and learn from Chris Allen, and, you know, go to art museums, go to these, you know, these monumental places that are going to inspire you, take in that inspiration, that's so important. I mean, again, I rave about the Cleveland Museum of Art.
Yeah.
All the time. I mean, just these are the great
places. It's an amazing, amazing place.
You'll find yourself, you resonate, you know, within those environments. You know, do all these current events and stress-fueled lifestyles, you know, do they inspire your music, or is it just, are you able to push all this stress, if you will, aside
from current events?
Yeah, and find yourself in simple living and simple writing and all of that.
Well, I mean, that's what I try to do.
There's simplicity in all the things that you're doing.
It's hard. I mean, like, People Need Targets off this record was my kind of answer to that, where it's, you know, I don't understand, you know, why everybody's become such voyeurs in this world. Mm-hmm. And we just with the cell phones and everybody's on them all the time, the lack of in the moment is a little crazy when you're playing out all the time. And sometimes you'll be playing and people will be like looking at doing the thing. Uh-huh. And they're like, great show. It's like, did you watch the show? Or were you watching the phone?
It's tragic.
But I mean, to me, that's why, like, I find myself writing more very late at night or very early in the morning, mm-hmm. before all the static starts. Okay. And it's, you know, like everybody deals with it. I mean, it's just, there is a lot of overload.
It is a lot of sensory overload, but it's, you know, it's how you deal with it.
Yeah, and I see guys like Paul Westerberg saying, you know, or different writers say, I'm not going to write anymore. Right. I'm going to throw it all out. And maybe that's the right answer. To me, it's not. To me, it's, you know, if you love to write and you love to make music, then you need to do that.
Right.
Even if you write it and just do it for yourself.
Sure.
Doesn't mean you should stop doing it because the rest of the world is bombarding you.
Chris Allen, your obvious passion makes you the great artist that you are, and the great writer that you are. And I think that's great. What's the, what is the biggest challenge, growth challenge now in the career of Chris Allen? I mean, this is a great CD. Where's it going?
Where's it going to go? You know, I just, the same thing I told, my sister Molly is a big, big part of my team. Mm-hmm. And like I told her, it's always about writing. It's always about doing another record. I'm doing two records next month.
Wow.
And that, to me, to write another great record, that's the challenge. What happens with it, you know, I don't know. I mean, that's not...
Well, people ultimately come around. When people hear it, and you know, we all honor the quality, we're drawn to it, and we're drawn to the source. It's like good water coming from a spring. We're going to go back to that spring every time. So if you, you know, if you're going to be the spring and keep generating that, that
well, and it's just a matter of making great records. I mean, I could name 10 records right now that anybody watching this show probably has never heard of. Mm-hmm. Dan Zane's Cool Down Time, you know, Warren Zane's. You know, different records that you would know that you'd never, Joe Henry, okay. Trampoline, records nobody would know of. It doesn't, mm-hmm. you know, it doesn't make them less important because they didn't sell a million copies.
Sure.
It's about making a great statement. And it's, you know, to me, I just distrust artists that are so more involved in the pushing of it rather than the making of it.
Sure.
To me, it's the making of it that's the most important thing. And, you know, that's what I love about it, and I don't, I'm ever going to change that.
Well, and marketing people will tell you, it's not, it's no longer a push world, it's a pull world.
Right.
You know, you're not pushing things onto people anymore. You're engaging them, and you're pulling their interest toward you and sustaining their interest. And, you know, you being a prolific writer means you're continuing to release product, quality product, and fans will stay loyal to you. You know, so it's it works and works with any career, so it's so important. I hope there's going to be some new photos out there, some live videos
It'll
out there.
It'll be rolling.
You could use a few more live videos, okay?
It'll
Chris
be rolling.
Allen, okay. Some merch, you know, we got to get some Chris Allen merch going. So, you know, all the stuff, you know, it's going to be so important to your career because, wow, you are, you know, you're on a roll, Chris Allen, and it's so exciting. Any big future gigs that our listeners need to get to? And I'll be there, too.
Doc, I am doing a solo acoustic gig tomorrow at the Harp.
Okay.
And after that, I am taking some time off because I'll be finishing up writing the records.
Okay.
And recording. I mean, I'm going into the studio, going underground.
Wow, that's it. That, and it seems like it's your home, but it's great. You know, just great. Well, congratulations to you, Chris Allen.
You are
one heck of a songwriter. What an impressive career and even a brighter and brighter future. So thank you for staying in Cleveland. Yeah. Thank you for giving us all
the good
music.
I'm not going anywhere.
Good. Well, geographically, but at least career-wise, sky's the limit. As they say, you shoot for the moon, you might miss and hit a star. So it's worth the doing. Well, great. Good to have you here in the recovery room. And, of course, good to have you here as well. I'd like to say thanks to my Band-Aid production team, the intern wizards who are running around helping us out tonight. Social Racket, my bud's out there doing her thing. Jared Holly, he's a real mecca in the music business and a real pal to this show. And, of course, the Flying V, he's the big guy back there who puts it all together. But you know what? The most important person on this team is you because you're logging onto this podcast and you really are a part of this team. On August 30th, we're going to learn about the importance of having good business relationships from an experienced CPA. That's right, Drew Cate. He's actually a former rock drummer. Drew Cate is among the finest, and he'll be here to help you understand the importance of running your business and keeping proper accounting practices. And that's so very, very vital, and there's nobody any better than Drew Cate to have on the show. So that's next week on Tuesday, August 30th. Also, in the recovery room next week, we'll meet a band who's scoring the most live gigs in Northeastern Ohio. That's right, the 90s mega dance band Hat Trick, who actually do three different sounds and three different looks all in the same show each evening. They're a big success story. They're going, wow, it is great. And they are a great cover band. So they're going to be here next week. Hat Trick will be a lot of fun. We'll also be injecting the latest rave bands, The Decor from Charlotte, North Carolina, along with a very talented acoustic pop artist, Paper Lungs. He's from Altamont, Kansas. So it's going to be kind of exciting. I will surely be smashing some bams for them on that show next week. You know, any civilization thrives on culture. It defines who we are and often forecasts where we are going as a humanity. You and your art are contributors to pop culture, and therein lies a responsibility to contribute with quality content and not just making mere noise. Give of yourself and use your talent for the betterment of humankind. It is your mission, and it will rock your world. I'll see you at the top. Namaste.
All this energy calling me back where it comes from. It's such a crude attitude. It's back where it belongs. All the little kids growing up on the skids are going Cleveland rocks, Cleveland rocks. Jumpin' Gene.
climate, and keep on rocking for the free world.